Where do I get my link? Where's my link? Stream link. Server. Okay, let's see if I am now streaming on my YouTube channel. What? Pasta Grannies? Have you not watched the Pasta Grannies? Like, seriously. The Pasta Grannies? I totally think you should all watch the Pasta Grannies. It is the most charming of websites and YouTube channels out there. These old ladies make pasta. We love it. We make pasta along with these old ladies. They're the best. Seriously. This is my life goal, to be one of these ladies.
Oggi facciamo un po' più simile a cavatelle. C'è mia sorella.
It is the best channel. I will let you watch that on your own. I need to find my own channel here. Let's see if I can find the link so that I can... Where is my link? Go live. Let's see if this works. Am I live streaming now? ANOVA NT test analysis for Likert data. And I will make this public. And this is colon 1313 Niagara College W20. And let's see. I need to figure out how it will capture my screen data. So I'm using my encoders streaming. And I want display capture. Yes, I have the stream encoder. Now, where are my options? Enable DVR. Here's my question. Okay, let's see. Here's my server URL. I'm going to share the server URL through Blackboard, and I want to see if you are able to see my server URL. Okay, let's see if this is going. I should have just shared the live stream. No, I did not. I want to see if you can see, what I'm doing and if you can hear audio-wise on your laptop. For those of you who are coming in late, we're testing to see if I'm able to do a live stream of this lecture through YouTube. I just put the live stream studio link in Blackboard under, we're in the statistics essentials folder, and I just put the live stream URL for Inova. I'm hoping that at this point, this is picking up a live stream and it's a screen capture of my computer screen. So let's test this out to see if it's going to work, if we're able to patch this all together. No, it is, so in documents, in the live stream URL Inova, that should be a web link to my YouTube dashboard. Is it working? Yeah, and so is it, it should be in there, sorry, as, I've got too many tabs open, Livestream URL Inova. I want to see if we can get the bugs out today, just in case. Again, I'm being in emergency preparedness mode, knowing that we just were sent a message this morning that we're being aware. So Apple computers are not accepting it? Does Safari open YouTube? Look up Amy Prue on YouTube. Are you listening to me with like a 30-second delay?
Yes.
Yeah. Oh my God.
So we did it. Okay. Okay. This is going to be a real pain in the butt. But we may have. Now.
So. I actually want to see if I can switch screens, and it's going to be really weird here. So just in case, you should be able to go to Amy Prue. I did an Amy Prue Inova. Oh man, this is, come on. There are a few different Amy Prues. I know one of the Amy Prues on YouTube likes UFOs.
That's so cool.
That's not me. When I first moved to Niagara, there were a couple Amy Prues who lived in Niagara. Okay, there we go. Oh, 7 of you are watching. When I first moved to Niagara, there were a couple Amy Prues who lived in Niagara. Okay, there we go. Oh, 7 of you are watching. When I first oh my God. So it's going to be a real pain in the butt here. Okay. I'm going to turn this. What we're doing here today is we're innovating. We're innovating in the classroom teaching model in that, just in case, heaven forbid, the college says we are going to be canceling classes, I have a mechanism that where I can turn around just like that and say, okay, folks, lecture's on. I'm going to be lecturing from my couch, and you can hang out wherever you feel comfortable, whether that's at your couch or at your friend's house or in your grandma's basement, wherever you feel is the most appropriate for you to be. We will lecture. We will graduate on time. Okay, so let's get on with. Now we know there are two ways. I can share a link directly with you, or you can look up my channel. So look up Amy Prue channel. And the Amy Prue channel should be at a live stream. I would announce through Blackboard in advance that I will go live stream at this time. And from there, I would be providing you with the content and some sort of activity that we can do together. Now, what I want to see is, are you able to send me messages? Okay. We're living in the future, David. Karen Aurora, Amy 2020. Yes, we can. Woo! Thanks. Thanks for your kind words of encouragement here. So I almost think that if I'm going to live stream, I need two screens, because I'm likely going to be live streaming from a screen capture. Because you know me, I'll be likely talking about a spreadsheet or a PowerPoint. But then if I have a second screen, I can see your chat questions. So if Asia says, hey, how do you do a histogram? I can say, okay, great question, Asia. Let's walk back and do that again. Yeah, go innovation. Thank you for your patience. Okay, let's jump in here and let's remember, what does a Likert panel look like? So when we collected that data, I'm tempted actually to, should we do the try this yourself or no? I'll leave the try it yourself and let you do that yourself. Let's walk backwards with some data here. Remember last week we had the compliments ginger snaps, those round crinkly ones. We had the dare simply spice, and we had those Dutch windmill cookies, the speculoos. I had built an online survey tool, and in that online survey tool, we were collecting how many people disliked extremely, how many people disliked slightly, neutral, liked slightly, liked extremely. Should I pull up that survey tool data and remind us what it looked like? Yes, let's do that. So I did it in SurveyMonkey, but the assignment that you're working on right now, you might be working from Google Forms, pardon me, I was going to say Google Docs. You can see people answered the survey in 2017, 2018, 2019, but let's go down and see. You know what? I'm in the wrong tab here. I want question summaries. Remember, SurveyMonkey's extremely common within industry, and it has some really nice features, but you can't just go and export your data. You have to go and look at that data in an aggregate form. Yes. Yes, I can. You know what? Here's the key question. We all know how to get into the YouTube platform now? I'm just going to shut the YouTube stream off just to keep myself from going crazy here. Main thing is, we proved a point. We found out a mechanism so that I can continue lecturing just in case the college, for any reason, were to shut down. I can. Just like that, we all know a mechanism to be able to get into a YouTube live stream so that we can continue lectures if for some reason there's a problem and we can't meet in person. Cool? I'm just going to shut this off and we're going to go straight to... Woohoo! Okay. So, I'm in SurveyMonkey right now, and I'm just looking at my raw data. I would be going along, I did the slightly made for TV version. I should be going along with my spreadsheet and taking this raw data from the dislike extremely, dislike slightly, neutral, like slightly, like extremely, and so on. Now, depending on the survey tool that you're using, it will sometimes bump it out like this, where it will say seven people disliked it extremely and so on. You can go straight to a histogram style bar chart with that data. Other times you'll see it like this, where you'll get panelist one. Panelist one answered four for ginger snap, five for dare simply, and you're like, what? Where did that 4, 5, 2 come from? I numerically coded dislike extremely as 1, dislike slightly as 2, neutral as 3, like slightly as 4, and liked extremely as 5. Make sense? Kind of? Yes? Sort of? And if I go in and get the individual data, I can go into SurveyMonkey and pull individual data. It would be, oh, where is it? This would be it, Q5. I would be going through each individual response and pulling it from there. Let's see if we can do a t-test in ANOVA. So, oh shit, pardon me. That was, sorry, am I still live streaming? I have no idea.
Yes, you are.
Am I? Okay. Oh, you know what? Let's see if I can switch the live stream. Do I have enough battery to switch the live stream? Here's the question. For those of you who are still live streaming, I'm dead curious if I can go to the chalkboard. And I'm going to change my display capture. Yes. I'm going to switch it to a video capture. Okay. And I'm going to, oh, no, I just deleted the wrong one. I want video capture. Okay. Let's see what happens if I stick this. Good times. For those of you who are watching on my YouTube live stream, I am now live streaming the blackboard, or the whiteboard, or whatever kind of board you want to call this. Let's talk about some of the theory behind the stats. So, we talked about histograms last week. That histogram, what we're doing is we're going along and saying, we're going to... That's my histogram. Talk to me. Is this a great product?
Hey, why is the last one the only one who buys it in circles?
Because he's so... Honestly, I just had to review a survey tool for a cannabis company for doing liquor.
Is that within the line one next to the right? Sorry.
Here, I will do this better. Better? Okay, now we're better. Tell me about this product. Is this a good product? We learned how to do a histogram. In a moment, I will remind us about that histogram. But take a look at this data. It's sort of this nice, lovely bell curve. Now, do I have another colored marker in my pocket? Oh, it's black. Let me see if I've got
the
red.
Population likes it.
Most of the population doesn't.
We're taking this histogram data and we're seeing how it looks.
Do you have any?
From a normalization perspective. Now, let's make another set of data. Here's the question. Is it the same or is it not the same?
Most of them are neutral.
No one likes it extremely.
We're really in a bind right now to ask that question, is the data the same or is it not the same? This is histogramified. I'm using that word. I'm going to make it up. But let's just generalize. Again, using that same modality. Think of a histogram. This time I'm just going to throw curves at you instead.
I need a black and a red because I want to have two different colors. No one's colorblind for red, are they? So, here's a question. Mr. Graham won. Whoa. Mr. Graham two. Are they the same? What we're looking at is these bell curves, and these bell curves are showing us two key features. They are showing us where the mean is. More or less the mean is going down the middle. We can take those points of data too, and you saw how I turned it into numbers. I can ask the question, what's the mean? What's the average of that data? And if I look at the average of that data, pretty darn close. But are they the same? That's really the crux of our question today. And so there are two. Now, I need a third color marker, and I only have red and black today. Oh, you have a pocketful. I have my airplane bag right now.
I've been lazy to switch from my airplane bag because it's light. I'm about 40
degrees.
I just need one more color. If I put this blue line here, blue versus black, are they the same? What's the same about them and what's different about them? They're the same area. We're looking at the area under the curve, but we're also looking at what's their mean. In this case, the blue is very different mean-wise from the black. Why would the area under the curve be the same?
The same distribution and the same percentage.
Yeah, so we're making the assumption that it goes back to that histogram again. If we have that histogram and it's a bar chart, each of these is like a cube, or not a cube, a square, representing one response. We're just aggregating and smoothing out the lines to express the data and think about the mathematical concepts from an intuitive perspective. Again, I'm not a statistician, and I'm not a mathematician, and I'm not even a sensory scientist. I am a generalist food scientist who loves you and is trying your best. Aww. But let's think about it. If I've got, how many respondents did I have here? I had 3 + 5 = 8. I had 10, 13 respondents. The area really is reflected. If I had 13 here, I had 13 here. The area under that curve is the same. So if I had 13 respondents in the red group, the area under the curve, in theory, is the same. But what we're seeing is that mean, where's the central tendency in that data? That mean could be different, and the spread of that curve. Is it elongated out over a wide distance? Or is it really discrete? That elongation is expressed as a standard deviation. So what we're really worried about here is mean, standard deviation, and we are worried about the number. Or what we call the N number. Now, we're going to start first by doing a grouped in two comparison. If I just have the black and blue, are they the same or are they different? And that's what we would call a t-test. Sometimes you'll see it as a student's t-test. Did you do this before? Kyler's nodding his head, and is that may be because he's just totally engaged in the process, but it done this before or no? Maybe. We may have done it in chemistry class. We may have done it slightly vaguely in this class. I want you to be able to do it yourself from here on out. I don't expect you to be able to do all the math from first principles. I want you to be able to say, I have two sets of data. I need to know if the mean and standard deviation are the same or are they different? Because if you're collecting Likert data and you have two very similar data sets, you need to be able to go out and say confidently, you know what, we surveyed 20 people, the means are coming back similar, but if I've got this red and black comparison, even though the means are the same, should I be walking back and saying, yeah, the results are the same? No. And because the standard deviation is so different, it should be showing it as two different analyses. So, I'm having too much fun multitasking here with this live stream. I'm going to now take my live stream back to computer land. This is hilarious. Remember that I've got your marker. Let's go back to, can you see my screen? And I removed the video capture, and it should be back to screen capture again. Let's go into my data set here. Here's my Likert panel results. I'm going to scroll in and... What did I do first with my Likert panel? First and foremost, I like to visualize my data. So I did my histogram. Do you remember how to do a histogram? Can someone walk me through how I did the histogram? Here, I'm actually going to delete this histogram data set. What was the first thing I needed to do? To get my histogram out, actually, I'm going to delete that histogram right out. First thing I did, I set my bins. Using the Excel terminology, I set my bins. So I remembered my survey tool said disliked extremely, disliked slightly, neutral, liked slightly, liked extremely. I went into my data set. To be honest, I actually just did some made for TV data, but I should be going back to my survey results. And I go, okay, panelist number one said neutral, neutral, neutral. And if I remember the key for that, it should be 333. In Google Docs, I can export it straight out as a Excel file. And it would look sort of like this. A little bit of tweaking. I put some headings in there to make it a little bit more straightforward to read. But I converted every one of my scores into a number. I'm just for clarity's sake, I'm going to get rid of these boundaries here. Now, do you remember how to find the histogram toolkit? To find the histogram toolkit, I had to go into data and data analysis. And if you haven't done the turn-on for the data analysis toolkit in Excel, you have to go into file, into options, and then in here, in the add-ins section, down at the bottom, there are additional Excel add-ins, and you can go. And now you can turn on your all these fancy additional stats tools. Analysis Tool Pack and Analysis VBA. Click OK, and I'm good to go. Now, when I go into data, I have data analysis here. Click on data analysis, and there is a t-test tool in here. I actually am going to show you a different one. We're going to do the histograms in here at least. So click OK. My input range, that was for the first data set, it was going to be this Compliments Ginger Snap. That's my input range. My bin range was this. And in this case, do I want a Pareto or a cumulative percentage? Do you remember last time we were doing it in the best estimate threshold and we wanted a cumulative percentage?
Does a cumulative percentage curve make sense this time? No. No, it's not going to give us the bell curve. It's going to give us, when do we get to 100%? We don't want a cumulative percentage. We just want a chart. And I'm just going to set the chart. Let's set the chart right here. Let me click OK, and there's my histogram. Let's just double check. Remind yourself, when you're doing a histogram, double check and see, does it make sense? Does it make sense? I have five number fives. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and everything else is a 4. Hey, good job, histogram. Just for clarity, I'm going to say compliments Ginger Snap. Now, here's the thing. This histogram is only showing me one bar set. How do I add an additional bar set? I need to do another histogram. Histogram, okay. I may actually be better off input range DARE, Simply Spice. Bin range is the same as before. Output range, let's set it down here. And you're like, wait a second, now I've got two bar charts. This is silly. I'm actually going to delete these bar charts because I think it's actually easier after the fact to make a new bar chart and overlay the three sets of bars together. So that was DARE. Let's remind ourselves, did it make sense? DARE, how many fives did we have? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 6. Yes, the histogram worked. Do it one more time. Histogram. Okay. Input range. Bin range, the same as before. Output range, let's set it down here. Okay. I should have turned the chart output off. Ah. Let's just move that over. And that was Dutch. Now if I make a bar chart with those three data sets, insert histogram and add the data in manually, it will make far more sense than trying to do it within the insert. Two D column. And if I select my data, add my legends. And let's add it. Did I get this right? Nope, I did not get it right. See, I'm going to screw up again. Insert. Let's see what happens if I do this. Data analysis, histogram. I want to see if I can actually reverse and add more select data. Let's see where they pulled this from. One, two, three, four, five. So let's do this. Add. And series values. And add. And series values. Now did it overlay correctly? Yes. I need to swap those labels off. Talk to me about your data. Blue should be format legend. Nope. Blue is the Dutch cookies. Orange is the R complements, and no, gray is the R complements. I need to switch these data tables around. The source file that I gave to you did it correctly. I hate making Excel graphs. You can see how bad I am at it. It takes me 10 times. But you have to go back to your intuition to figure out that you've got it done right. Now, here's the question. Not blue versus orange. Orange versus gray, are they the same? Is orange versus gray the same? What we're going to think about is that t-test. So, I gave you a link to an internet-based tool in your Blackboard, and it says online calculator ANOVA with Tukey's postdoc. I'm going to talk about what ANOVA with Tukey's postdoc is in just a moment. I do encourage you to go and read this whole thing. But right now what I want to show you is, let's do an initial t-test. K equals 2. We've only got, K should be how many data sets are you working from? And so K equals 2 in this case. We have K columns of data observations. And then I will click enter my data. I like this because it doesn't just give you out a bunch of whole statistical parameters that you then have to go and readdress in a second table. This tool will do the full analysis for you, and it will carry you forward into an ANOVA as well. So I've got this tool open, and I want to know, are my complements ginger snaps the same, or are they different than each other, or than the Dare Simplies? So I'm going to take the data from my complements ginger snap. If I look at my mean, let me just pull this up here for a second. I did the mean values. You know how to do mean values in Excel, average of your array. I gave you the equations. So to get the mean value equals average, and then put the array in, and there you go, 4.5. The average is 4.5 on the complements and 4.4 on the Dare Simply Spice. Are they the same or different? Let's see what our t-test tells us. Our standard deviations are not the same though. Check this out. They are much more spread on the Dare Simply Spice. A small, tight curve means a very small standard deviation. In a moment, I'm going to play with the data and muck it up for you. So I'm going to cut and paste it into here. So that was sample A and sample B. Copy. And we click the magic button. Boom. There's our input data. If I ran it in Excel, that would put out a table like this, and you would sit and scratch your head going, what the hell is this? And a week from now, you would forget. I studied this in grad school, I forget. Honestly, I'm not a statistician. I'm an end user of statistics. What I really want to know is way down here. There's a lot of harmonic mean calculations and post-hoc. This is really what I'm worried about. So, is the difference between these significant or is it insignificant? Do you remember hypothesis testing? Our hypothesis for this is the difference significant and different or is it insignificant? And the box says it is, the difference is, red box, insignificant. Can I play with the data with you just to show you how let's muck it up here in 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, 4, creation. And let's do 1, 1, 1. Oh, no, that's not enter. 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, and 2. In theory, the standard deviation is the same. Data table the same? You think it's same or different? Drumroll, please. I'll click the button. It should be different. The standard deviation is the same. It is different. Surprise. Honestly, the fun of these calculators is if you're not getting it, muck around with data that's intuitive to you before you jump into data that's not intuitive. Make up some fake data. Let's go back and see what happens if I do. So let's do this one more time. I'm going to copy this. Ah! So I copied my data set from my tabulated data here. That was sample A and Dare Simply Spice. Let's try that and paste it there. Click. T-test data says they are the same. And when I say the same, that means that the difference is insignificant. T-test data says the difference is insignificant. Now, let's go back one more time. Should we do complements ginger snap versus Dutch speculoos? Just for fun. So complements was there. Let's put the Dutch speculoos data in column B this time. We know from our histogram, let's predict, let's find our histogram down here. Dutch speculoos was the blue, and our complements ginger snaps was the gray. I need to change those titles for those of you who just walked in. Blue, gray, same, different. Tell me. Interpret it for me. Blue versus gray should be different. So, thinking of our hypothesis testing, is the difference significant or insignificant? If they're different, the difference is significant or insignificant? Predict, is it going to be a green box or a red box? I'm going to click the button and drumroll, please. So the difference, take a look. Remember way back where we were talking about p-values. Remember where you were talking about p-values in difference testing? Do you remember what the p-value that we, as scientists, we routinely say this is the p-value at which we are confident?
0.05. So how confident are we right now?
Over 99%.
We're over 99% confident.
Does that make any sense? Do we need a coffee break? Because we're going to go into ANOVA next, and ANOVA is where it gets even funner, faster. Ooh. Coffee break? Good idea? Let's take a coffee break and reconvene around, it's 4:40, so 4:50-ish, 10 minutes. So, t-test. Good times. The data, the same or different in a set of two. Now we're going to, if ANOVA's going to jump, we can have 3, we can have 10, we can have 100 data sets, and we can tell the difference between the two, or 10. That's fine. Monday was a disaster. How was it?
Sunflower seeds do not work, so I don't think I can make it nut free.
Okay.
But flavors definitely get better. If you want to see what I'm learning, which is the cheddar version, make it a little more orange.
Paprika? Sorry? Oh, I'm still streaming. This is where I should put on my, the music interlude. What would be the good music interlude for a coffee break in the middle of a live stream? If I'm live streaming for my couch, you'll see my kitchen. Sing. I don't have any pets, but I have a goose that lives on my patio right now. I'll introduce you to my goose. I have been making vegan cheese sauce for my kid for a long time, and paprika with turmeric does a really cool orange.
So I was thinking paprika, but then Norm was like, don't use paprika, it'll change the flavor. And I'm thinking if I add a little bit at a time, I get some color to change the flavor.
If you were in the industry and scaling this too, you would likely be getting a decharacterized paprika oleo resin. Just saying. Decharacterized paprika oleo resin doesn't have a lot of flavor, but has a lot of orange. It could be annatto. There may be annatto up in the Central Stores usually has it for Mexican Week. Annatto has the orange pigment is called pixin, and it's a good bright orange as well. Wouldn't need much of it. Main thing is,
well, it's also a kit, so
yeah.
It's basically here's all the ingredients, here's the instruction book, make it at home. I'm just trying to test the cheese so that I have a decent enough recipe to be like, follow these instructions, here you go.
And honestly, do you want to, so thank you for reminding me about that, because then are you working with annatto and paprika oleo resins? No. Most likely you're going to be sticking with a little tiny sachet of
something
a dried
dry,
spice.
Yeah.
And so push back on Norm. I'm sorry, Norm. We're picking a good quality paprika that delivers decent color. Without, and again, too, I think part of this, when you evoke the right color, you evoke the sensory that you're after. I think of my kid and the vegan macaroni and cheese sauce that we were working on. She was like, this is awesome. I'm like, it's butternut squash. She's like, it's so creamy and cheesy. Because it's orange. We do it. We do have beet powder.
Yeah, Aaron's been working with that for cheese sauce.
The beet powder, depending on the circumstances, can lean towards the bluish side. Whereas in this case, we want to lean towards the orange-red side of the redness.
I think I'll test with paprika first, see where that goes. Because like most vegans would want something natural, and like they wouldn't want a thing of food coloring to be like, here, make it look orange.
No, whereas natural organic, it doesn't have to be organic, but I'm thinking vegan style. Natural spices, no problem. And they'll recognize it. And is the intent for people to be learning through this kit so they can do it independently, or to be buying this kit routinely for fun and entertainment?
Good question.
I'm thinking of the 30-minute mozzarella kit. Have you seen that kit?
I have.
This is a cheese-making kit. And honestly, they've been around for several decades. New England cheese. That's it. And the idea behind this it's a dairy cheese making kit.
Mm-hmm.
And it really, honestly, what it is it's the rennet tablets and it's the citric acid.
Yeah.
That's all it is.
Milk, basically.
Provide your own milk. And she used it, her mindset was to use it as a gateway. She also runs a cheese making supply company. And then after you've made it 30 times,
mm-hmm.
at that point you're confident to buy the ingredients directly.
Yeah.
But she makes an awesome margin on it. And why? If parents buy this to entertain their kids and Girl Guides
mm-hmm.
and Boy Scouts and get it as a fun activity to try out.
Mm-hmm.
And I bought one of these 20 plus years ago to make with the students and the residents. They're still around because people find it intriguing. And that's why I think you've hit a really intriguing concept,
mm-hmm.
that people who are in the vegan healthy spectrum oftentimes also overlap with the make it yourself, back to the land, or urban back to the landing, where I'm,
mm-hmm.
like, I'm raising sprouts and I'm mason jar on my windowsill,
yeah.
sort of thing. Been there, done that.
I'm raising sprouts in the basement.
So immerse yourself in who is that segment customer and think about their story arc. Are they going to be, I could totally see this in places like Goodness Me or in Whole Foods or
something like that, yeah.
Where people could have the fun of the craftiness but not have to buy all of the supplies in large quantity.
Mm-hmm. And it's, especially since with cheese making kits, you're like, I want to eat it right away, right? So you'll use it up almost immediately, store it in the fridge maybe for 2 to 3 days, and be like, I used it all up, so now to make more, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, I used oat milk for my cheddar this time, so it didn't have that coconut flavor to it. Oat milk's a little sweet.
It can be, yeah. What they have done, most of the oat milk manufacturers have taken the oat, and to increase the sweetness without adding a sugar line, they're adding amylase. And it's hilarious to me. I'm dying of thirst here for some reason.
Keep talking with me. I was thinking about that. I need to find a bigger cup.
I don't understand why they feel the need to make it sweet when it's supposed to be milk. Unless there's something about the flavor they really need to cover up.
I think when you don't the likelihood of me having to go on quarantine is possibly higher because of my husband being a firefighter EMT,
mm-hmm.
and him being exposed, the likelihood of that is higher than the general public. And she's like, what if we run out of milk? I'm like, we always have like 6 bags of milk in the freezer down in the basement. And if for some reason we were to run out of that, we could make oat milk. She's like, oh, okay. Yeah, because we do make oat milk.
So if you don't need
bunny,
you don't need milk to survive either. You can just
I do like milk in my coffee.
buy a cow or a goat. Keep it in your home.
Honestly, when you make oat milk from scratch, it does have a chalkiness to it.
Mm.
And by using the amylase, you're breaking down that chalkiness and contributing a lot more maltodextrins and a lot more oligodextrins that have that slight sweetness. The longer you let that amylase run, the more sweetness. How many two of the people who are these grain-based milk analog consumers are so used to like hyper-sweetened chocolate and vanilla-flavored ones that their emotional expectation is on the sweet spectrum?
Yeah.
See, the thing is, with this recipe, you can use any plant-based milk. So it's more so I'm going to test it with this one because that way it won't taste like coconut. I'm going to test it with this one. It has nuts in it, but maybe it tastes better, you know?
I would, yeah. How many? I'm thinking of some of my vegan nightmares of having vegan roommates, and they would put the sweetened vanilla flavor in like a cauliflower, cream of cauliflower soup or something.
Ew.
Oh yeah. Do be aware of that sort of potential mistake and make sure either in your consumer instructions, that it's really, really clearly articulated. Or what would happen if you're that, I'm just imagining I'm a teenage kid, 14-year-old girl, I'm at home after school, parents are away, and I'm experimenting with stuff in the cupboard.
Mm-hmm.
I let my kid do that. She made a frozen pizza yesterday. She's 12 years old. Kid goes along and is hungry and is experimenting. What would it taste like if it was a sweet cheese? And you didn't put the paprika in and the turmeric. I'm dead curious, because if I was that 14-year-old girl and I'm like, shoot, I can't get out to the store because I'm 14.
But I gotta use what I have here.
Or yeah, I'm just thinking of all sorts of circumstances. I just was out at the store. I thought I had everything. I was looking forward to relaxing and making this kit and having a relaxing evening, doing something crafty. And this is all I have. Is there an alternative present? What would it taste like if it was made with chocolate flavored milk?
Oh God!
Just try it out. Like,
yeah.
I know you've only got 5 weeks.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm just right now. We had
dessert cheese.
Yeah, totally.
It's called mascarpone. It's very famous.
Mascarpone cheese, ricotta is often served.
Yeah, for some reason I thought of ricotta.
As dessert, burrata is often served with dessert. Even many of the nice neutral cheeses with jam, brie.
Brie serve with chocolate a lot.
Yeah. And so what's the versatility? If you said, do not add pouch number two and have a dessert cheese with your chocolate flavored oat milk. Just something to think about. You don't have to go there, but I'm going Eureka Ranch mind right now and saying, how do you build as much versatility and as many innovative potentials into the product while still having one product?
Yeah, because the more avenues you have, the more likely you are to sell.
And that opportunity for, I can follow the instructions to the letter and have a really nice, consistent product, or I can improvise with the options available to me in the fridge or in the grocery store and customize the heck out of it too.
It'd also be interesting to have a YouTube channel or something that they could post their changes on.
Yeah, it's like, try this. This is delicious. I love it when I add a bit of this.
Yes, or Instagram it and say, here's my recipe. I swapped the milk for a pureed banana or something crazy like that.
Mm-hmm. Us for Excel how to do histograms, pie charts, and all that stuff. I sent you the document.
Thank you. I swear it's stage fright.
Well,
I get up here and I'm at home and I'm like, I'm making all these charts, and then I get up here and I'm like, shit, I forget everything.
Well, this is why I thought I'd just send you the document, and you can share the document with your pluses.
Excellent. Excellent. Okay. Let's jump into ANOVA land.
Yeah.
We just live streamed our coffee break. For those of you who are watching from home, this is Trippy watching me walk. Canadian Food and Wine Institute at Niagara College. All right.
No, dude. Yo, when I was there, bro. Dude.
So, here's my key question. We did a t-test. We were able to compare two sets of data. What happens if you've got three sets of data? We went through and did, let's compare blue and black. Let's compare black and red. Let's compare blue and red. What if you had 10 sets of data? Would you go through and do a t-test on every single set of data?
How much are
you paying? How much are you paying? You could go and hire a statistician. And honestly, I was really, when I went to graduate school, I was really very fortunate to be able to work over and over and over again with statisticians who helped with my data analysis. And I can't say enough about the value of finding a statistician or to be good friends with. Steve Gismondi, I think I put his photo up on the screen one day. Steve Gismondi is one of my favorite statisticians in the whole world, and he helped me considerably. Tim Schwinghammer, he's a good friend of mine as well. He is a statistician for the federal government, working out of Agriculture and Agri-Food Canada at the Lethbridge Research Station. And when I have stats questions, I say hello to him. And yesterday, actually, I was showing him photos of your ramen from Ramen Day, and because he was asking about what kind of ramen to keep in his office. Make friends with statisticians. Honestly, find math people in your life if you do not like math. There are ways that you can cope by finding the math people that can help you. So, back to our t-tests. Back to our t-tests. If we had 10 data sets, let's say we had the Our Compliments brand and the Ginger Snaps and the Irresistibles and the ones from the Netherlands and the ones from Sweden and the ones from France and the ones from Mexico, and we had 10 varieties and we did liquor testing on every single one of them, now how on earth do we make those comparisons? You would be sitting and t-testing forever, and is it actually valid to be doing that t-test over and over and over and over again? No, there are actual statistical methods. What we're doing is we're grazing the surface. And I want to give you another statistical method that is extremely accessible to you using computer-based, web-based calculators. We're actually using the exact same calculator that we just did the t-test with. So I'm going to jump back to my data set, and I'm practicing my live stream skills here. Do-do-do-do-do. But in theory, and if I go back to display capture, okay, and I remove video capture, I'm just practicing this because of getting a muscle memory for it. Let's go back to our data set. Oh, you know what I didn't do? I didn't text. Shoot. I didn't text to tell someone to go pick up Mona to take her to cadets. Sorry?
I was in current, go pick her up.
Go pick her up? Okay, text is done. I've got three data sets. Three data sets. How on earth am I going to do this? Well, if I go back to that lovely calculator, not that. If I go back to my calculator here,
If I go right back to the very beginning, K was how many data sets am I working from? In this case, I am working with 3. K equals 3. And then I'll click on enter my treatment data. Now I've got 3 columns. Hooray. Let's snag this data here. Copy and paste. Oh, come on. Copy and, oh, where's my web page? There we go. Copy and paste. And copy and paste. And drumroll, please, we're going to hit the calculate ANOVI with 2K. I'll explain to you what all these other goofy terms mean. So we input the data, K equals 3 independent treatments. K equals 3 independent treatments. Oh, we should, no, they're not coming in. They're all making faces up in the window at me, Jamie and Nathan. If you were to do ANOVA, and now let me show you, you can do ANOVA using that data analysis tool over here. ANOVA's built in here, but honestly, it's just gonna burp out this at you. And if we all look at these numbers,
honestly, again, I am not a statistician. I have instead made friends with lovely statisticians who help me with this. I want you to get to the tool piece of the puzzle. All those descriptive stats, honestly, they're a lot of gobbledygook. And I don't want to dismiss how important stats is. I'm not a statistician, I'm an end user.
You are end users too. Let's jump down. ANOVA, what is ANOVA really telling us? It is going through and doing every single one of those paired comparisons in a pile of all together. ANOVA stands for analysis of variance. And what is really the kicker in this whole process is this what's called Tukey's post hoc test. The Tukey's post hoc is where they are then going through again and doing that. Let's compare column A with column B. Let's compare column A with column C. Let's compare column B with column C. And it's adding in that additional layer of analysis to say, okay, among all of those groups, which ones are the same? Which ones are different? So I'm not scrolling down fast. Why? There we go. Talk to me.
A versus B. That was the ginger, the round B ginger snaps versus the Dare spice cookies. And C was the Dutch cookies. Is the liking score for A versus B?
Let's remind ourselves.
No, they were compliments, not irresistibles. B. They're simply those cookies? So, A, compliments ginger snap, B,
Dare Simply Spice. C, Dutch Speculoos.
A versus B.
With that data set, A versus B, are they the same or are they different? Should we look at the histogram? Let's remind ourselves with the histogram. Cancel. I should be able to scroll. Where's my histogram? Gray versus orange. Gray versus orange, are they the same or are they different? Gray versus orange is A versus B, are they the same or different? Let's do the opposite. This might make it easier. A versus C. Let's jump back to our histogram. A versus C. C was the... I love Excel. C would be blue. And A would be orange. Are orange and blue the same? Use your gut. Are orange and blue the same? Can I rename this? Why can't I edit it? Are orange and blue the same?
I feel like, did you watch the Star Trek? Did you guys Star Trek people on Netflix? Or? I feel like you and Captain Picard, and he's like, is 2 + 2 = 3? And Picard's like, no, it's 2 + 2 = 3. Oh, and then they try to kill Picard. You know what? Shannon's laughing, like, you know what I'm talking about. No?
No.
Is orange and blue the same?
No.
No, okay, thank you. I feel like I'm talking, okay, orange and blue the same. Thank you. Is A and C the same? A versus C the same? What did you say, Jacob?
We are that confident that they are different.
We are very confident they are not the same. Remember, the hypothesis here is, are they significant in their difference, or are they insignificant in their difference? So in this case, green, they're very significant in their difference. B versus C. Very significant in their difference. A versus B. Very significant in their difference.
So, ANOVA helps you with that, what's called a Tukey's post hoc analysis, that HSD, honestly, significant difference.
Is it honestly significant? And so now we can tell, when we've got multiple sets of data, the honest level of significance in the difference on that data set. I always say, do go back to that histogram. Why? Let me draw you one more here. Histogram. Because you can really... What happens? We talked about this last week. What happens if... This is a your data set. Get rid of the thread. You do need to go back to your histogram as that intuition to help you understand where things are. What happens if your data set looks like this? Is that possible? Does it mean there?
bimodal data. You have people who hate the product, and you have people who love the product. What do you do now? Is, here's your question, is ANOVA or a t-test going to help you? Not straight up. You can segment your data. You can segregate and say, we're only going to evaluate a population segment that actually scores neutral and above. And among it, the people who run this data, you can segregate it, but is it meaningful? I always go back and say, what is the meaning behind all of this? And essentially, if I saw this data and I said, you know what? The liking on the our compliments ginger snaps is the same as the Dare flour cookies. How is that going to influence my decision? It's not likely that I'm going to be doing the our compliments versus the Dare. It's more likely that I'm going to be doing Dare version 1 versus Dare version 2 versus Dare version 3. I just didn't have access to that, and I didn't want to grab myself off of making cookies all night. As much as I adore all of you, I don't have time to make batch after batch after batch of cookies. Just swap. But if you were R&D team, if you were the R&D team, you're not likely at this point doing that evaluation on three competitors to figure out the level. You're more likely doing your internal competition on your versions. Does that make sense? So I'm thinking Asia's cheese. She had a couple different versions of cheese, and she would put version A cheese, version B cheese, version C cheese, and figure out which of these cheeses was preferred by the population. And if the data was tight, and the histogram was not conclusively saying what the population skews one way or the other, she could be doing that ANOVA or Tukey's post hoc to say, indeed, version A and version B, the liking on that is the same. And so you can go on other factors, like what the cost of goods, what's the ease of making this, what's the feasibility on getting the ingredients. Instead of just saying, this is our only key decision when making the final decision. Make sense? Would you ever do it on competitors? Possibly. If you were Coca-Cola, I surely guarantee that they're running internal testing with a wide variety of different groups when new cola type innovations are coming in. Let's see how the competitors stack up. And let's see what the liking is on that, on different populations.
Does there any conflict in terms with like using, for my product, the palm oil free vegan butter, there's really only one other brand on the market right now. It's literally just one that like brand itself is palm oil free. If I use them in this kind of testing, and like, would I have to keep it a secret that it's that brand, or would I have to say their name, or does it really matter at all?
From a heuristics perspective, usually you wouldn't be putting out the branding or all of the identity of that product. You would be putting out, here's product A, here's product B, which do you prefer?
But legality, literature-wise, I
if,
would you
buy,
in trouble.
If you can go buy it in the grocery store, there's no reason that you can't test it.
Could you post like the results? But, like, let's say that you can't tell the difference. Would you like post, oh, our cheese is better than so and so? That's why.
You can't put blog bombs in.
Blog? That's a very good point. How many times will someone drop an influencer and say, blog bomb? Blog about my viable if you're using it from an advertising and marketing perspective. If you're using it for internal decision making, then no.
If you publish this research and show,
you would have to be getting extremely large populations to be ensuring that your test was statistically valid. Right now, I'm putting up data sets of 10. That's misleading to think that, oh, well, I can do this on 10 people, and then out of the 10 people that I tested, 8 out of 10 like biscuit A over biscuit B. Our populations are too small. If you were testing 10,000 people, then you would have a lot more statistical significance to be able to make a claim. If I was Coca-Cola, I would bet I could bankroll that level of statistical significance. If I was the Sasquatch Cheese Factory. If I was the Sasquatch Cheese Factory and I only had a farmer's market stand, then I would not be confident to put it just my that was from Monday. That was hilarious. We made up an imaginary business plan for the Sasquatch Cheese Factory. So if you are a small business, you have to be really, really careful of either companies coming in and saying, wait a second, cease and desist on your numbers. They could be also, in some cases, going after you for libel if they felt that you did not have statistical relevancy. But could you use it totally for internal communications to help with decision making? Absolutely. Reasons that companies may decide and use all over the place. More questions about this thing? Is ANOVA, did you do box and whisker plots? You have. Box and whisker plots? No? Okay, let's get the box and whisker plots. Box and whisker plot shows the, instead of a histogram, it shows it in a bar.
Let's see if I can do a box and whisker plot off the top of my head. Insert graph. Where is it? No, I don't want a stock chart. I want a... There we go, box and whisker. So box and whisker will help us show how much standard deviation we've got. Select data. Series name. Series values. And let's see, add. That is not showing up as it should. A box and let me just see if I can find a different tool. There we go. A box and whisker plot is a way to show your data set, and it will show how skewed your data is, different than a histogram. There we go.
So, the box and whisker. That's where you're going to take your median. What's your median? Is it the same as your mean? It's where the midpoint of your data is. And then it's going to separate it into quartiles and group it all together. And then you've got your interquartile range. And then it will also show you if you have outlying data. I'm almost tempted to make you guys a YouTube video instead of trying to talk out my rear end here about something that I know but I am not an expert at. But what a box and whisker plot is good to do is help you determine if.
Let's go back to our data set for a second here. That box plot, if I've got let's say here's my respondents, and let's say I don't have 10 respondents, I've got 100 respondents, and one person answers one and everybody else answers 5 5 4 4 5 5 4 4 4. One, that person who answered one is an outlier. They obviously have some potential genetic tendency to taste a spice or taste a flavoring agent differently than someone else. And when 90% of our respondents are saying it's a 5 or a 4 and you've got one, there are times when you can go through and determine that that person's an outlier, and then you would just automatically, you would highlight them and copy your data, obviously, justify why you're deleting them. But you would go through in that box and whisker and say, wait a second, those outliers who are not falling within our interquartile range are throwing off our standard deviation completely. And it's worth just not kicking them out of the panel. But here's another question. If you are using that box and whisker plot, and you're noticing, let's say, is he here? Oh, he is here. Let's say this Asquatch comes to your panel every day. Hi. He eats too many pine cones, and his flavor palette is completely out of whack. And say Mr. Sasquatch every day comes to your panel, and every day is an outlier. Then what do you say to your Sasquatch?
Hit the wall.
Sayonara, Sasquatch. Thank you very much for your service. We really appreciate you participating in our sensory panel. However, we do not feel that we need your services anymore. Thank you so much. Would that ever happen? Absolutely. If you found that a certain panelist was all the time an outlier, you are well within your right to say thank you very much. You know what? We appreciate you volunteering, but it's not going to work out. Thanks. Have some snack on the way out, or compensate them once and be moving on. There are times when those outliers show up. I think I should make you a box and whisker plot video instead of me trying to. Because I need a bigger data set, obviously. There's many data points. Again, how many people are usually in a heuristic panel? Remind me from last week? Usually between 50 and 100 people. Do you ever have it where you get that tag-along person who keeps showing up all the time, who shows up like a sore thumb every time you run some sort of sensory? Yes. And you have to find ways of gently flagging them and saying, you know what? Value your participation, and then you either let them participate and then throw the data out, or you gently.
really persnickety and possibly some form of discrimination, but in sensory, you go way back to our very first week where we talked about how if you've got that person who has a very distinctive genetic tendency towards being able to taste something or not taste something, or they're a smoker, or they have dysphagia, or maybe the day of they've got a cold, you've got plenty of justification why you don't have to have everyone participate. Conversely, you do want to make sure that you're getting a big enough representative sample so that your statistics are relevant. And if you are going out to make bold statements, the bigger the data set, the better. What else can I answer for you? So I feel like, should we move into QDA or should we? What do you want to do? What would you like to do? Sure, I like weird abstract questions. Super tasters? Possibly. Yeah, actually, this is... No, actually, I've thought of a scenario where this is possible. Let's say you have a super taster who consistently is an outlier and consistently picking up defects in products. Consistently, it may be worth soliciting them in some form. It may be worth having a focus group with them with that product. Or a small group. Did you talk about Golden Palette? Golden Palette is in so many companies where they're like, we don't do sensory. Yeah. And instead you've got a few key decision makers who oftentimes have experienced so many products through their lifespan that they just have an intuition about what's going to be desirable or not. Stick that outlier in with a golden palette person and have a focus group or a small group conversation with them. Let me tell you of a good example of us doing this. Back when we designed the Mad Beer, and we've all seen the posters around the hall with Becky pouring beer and graduate soldier. Very first activity we did was we bought every single non-alcoholic beer that we could find in the marketplace at the time. This is almost 10 years ago, so there wasn't nearly the same offering. It was stuff like O'Doul's and Beck's. And it was pretty disgusting. And they put me in the room, Becky in the room, and a chef, Bruce Warden, who heavy beer drinker, lovely person. He's now moved to Whistler. And Kevin Somerville, the program coordinator for Brewmaster at the time. And it stuck the five of us in a room. We had to sit and drink all this non-alcoholic beer. And then we had to drink real beer. And we just fought like cats and dogs with each other in a very pleasant and positive way. I was the non-taster. I drink beer, but I drink beer like a normal person. Becky, same. And then we had Warden, who has like a almost like a microscopic memory for every flavor piece. And you ask him, what's the flavor note on this? Benzene. What's the flavor note on this? Grass beans. What's the flavor note on this? Citra hops. And he just had that in it, but he wasn't a beer person. And then we had Kevin Somerville in there as a beer maker, and he then honed in on every single comment in that focus group and said, oh, here's where you adjust that. That's from the yeast. Here's where you adjust that. That's caused by the different grain inputs that you're putting in there. That's changed by boiling. And then Becky and I are collecting all this data and mapping it so that we are really honing in on what makes for an ideal beer.
I know if you've tried the bad beer now, you'll likely be going, damn, it's better not on the one. Why? Because everyone learned the technique from me and then to even better, which is exactly what it should be. It's exactly what it should be. We then segue into QDA. We built that attribute map based off of the focus group. We had honed in on what those key attributes were. We had our outlier, who was Bruce Warden, who could pick up everything and every defect possible. We put him in that group for a reason. Becky and I couldn't pick up defects. We didn't have a statistical representative population, but we had someone who was a golden palette who could hone in on every defect, a different golden palette who could hone in on every attribute and turn it into a processing step. And then we documented it all, built our map for QDA. Part of me is tempted to talk QDA and get started on it. Gonna say yes. Okay. What's the next step? Ooh, I'm gonna jump to
My notes here. I've had enough of Nova and T-test. Am I going to give an assignment? Right now, I still need to give you feedback on stuff, so I'm not going to give an assignment. But I'm going to keep this assignment in my back pocket. If for some reason we need to not have class in person anymore, can you take this data set, try this example yourself, which is in the same data set on the second tab? Could you get me out this box? I don't want Shafe results. I want Tukey's postdoc. Where is my Tukey's postdoc? There's my Tukey. Do be aware, you saw what I just did by mistake. I scrolled too far. Tukey's postdoc is the easiest and most logical. There are other multiple comparison tests, Shafe, Bonferroni, and so on. Let's stick to Tukey. Tukey's honestly significant difference. Can you get a histogram of three data sets and a Tukey's postdoc of Nova on that data set and be able to tell me what you see? I'm going to keep that assignment in my back pocket just in case I need to suddenly say, hey guys, we're not going to go and do consumer-facing sensory anymore. Here's an alternate backup assignment. I do recommend you try mucking around with these tools and think about what it means. I also encourage you to learn more stats as we go along. Okay, QDA. Course documents, QDA. This is fun because if you can do the ANOVA and Tukey's postdoc, it comes back in QDA as well. QDA file, here we are. Am I still live streaming? I am, oh my gosh.